Good evening, everyone, and welcome to the Women's History Month lecture. On a mild Minnesotan March evening, with just a touch of snow, I'm thrilled to see that so many of you came from all over town to hear our speaker, Nina Totenberg, one of the great voices in American news media. My name is Young-ok An, and I'm director of the Luann Dumer Center for Women at the University of St. Thomas. On behalf of all of us at the Women's Center, I'd like to give you a warm welcome to our signature event. We'll start the program with two songs sung by an all-female a cappella student group, Cadenza. So they are coming.
I don't mind letting you down easy, but just give it time. If it don't hurt now, just wait a while. Not the big fish in the pond no more. You are what they're feeding on. So what are you gonna do when the world don't orbit around you? Oh, so what are you gonna do when the world don't orbit around you? Oh, ain't it fun living in the real world?
Ain't it fun?
Ain't it good? You can ring anybody's bell and get what you want. Think it's easy to ignore trouble when you're living in a bubble. So what are you gonna do when the world don't orbit around you? Whoa. So what are you gonna do when nobody wants to fool with you? Whoa. Ain't it fun? Good, being all alone.
Ain't it fun?
You can't count on no one. Don't go crying to your mama, 'cause you're on your own in the real world. Don't go crying to your mama, 'cause you're on your own in the real world. Don't go crying to your mama, 'cause you're on your own in the real world. Don't go crying to your mama, 'cause you're on your own in the real world. Ain't it fun? Maybe now you're one of us. Ain't it fun? Ain't it fun? Ain't it fun? Ain't it fun? Living in the real world.
Ain't it fun?
Ain't it good? Ain't it good being all alone?
Ain't it fun?
Don't go crying. to your mama, 'cause you're on your own in the real world. Don't go crying to your mama, 'cause you're on your own in the real world. Don't go crying to your mama, 'cause you're on your own in the real world. Don't go crying to your mama, 'cause you're on your own in the real world.
All right. Do you want another song from Cadenza?
Sorry, I feel like I'm always in the industry.
Stand on the bus, stop your feet, start clapping. Got a real good feeling, something bad about to happen. Pulled up to the church, but I got so nervous. Had to back it on up, couldn't make it to the service. Grabbed all the cash underneath my mattress. Got a real good feeling, something bad about to happen. Ran into a girl in a pretty white dress. Rolled down the window, where you headed to next? Said I'm headed to the bar with my money out the mattress. Got a real good feeling, something bad about to happen. Stand on the bus, stomp your feet, start clapping. Got a real good feeling, something bad about to happen. Drinks keep coming, throw my head back laughing. Wake up in the morning, don't know what happened. Oh, something bad. Whoa, something bad. Now me and that girl that I met on the street, we're rolling down the road down to New Orleans. Got a full tank of gas and my money out the mattress. Got a real good feeling something bad about to happen. About to tear it up down in New Orleans, just like a real like Thelma and Louise. If the cops catch up, they're gonna call it kidnapping. Got a real good feeling something bad about to happen. Stand on the bus, stomp your feet, start clapping. Got a real good feeling something bad about to happen. Drinks keep coming, throw my head back and laughing. Wake up in the morning, don't know what happened. Whoa, something bad. Whoa, something bad. Stand on the bus, stomp your feet, start clapping. Got a real good feeling, something bad about to happen. Now the drinks keep coming, throw my head back and laughing. Wake up in the morning, don't know what happened. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Whoa, something bad. Whoa, something bad.
Thank you so much.
All right.
Thank you, Hannah, and the rest of Cadenza for opening tonight's program in such a beautiful way. Now, we have a terrific lecture tonight. Ms. Totenberg's talk will be about 40 minutes, followed by a question and answer session for about 30 minutes. You in the audience are invited to participate in that segment. Afterwards, Ms. Totenberg has graciously offered to greet and meet with guests in the lobby reception area for about 30 minutes as well. Thank you. We at the University of St. Thomas are very fortunate to have a Women's Center that provides great support and resources to faculty, staff, and students. It bears the late Dr. Luann Dummer's name, and it was established in 1993 through the endowment that she bequeathed in her will. Our aim is to empower women and educate our broader community on gender equity, diversity, and social justice. We'd like to recognize Luann's vision and legacy through this event. Tonight's lecture marks the 24th in a series of talks given by nationally and internationally acclaimed women speakers. This distinguished roster of speakers, which now include Ms. Totenberg, has enlightened our community on matters ranging from women's history to feminist politics, from literature to journalism, and from science to world health and environmental sustainability. Those of us at an educational institution today are standing upon the shoulders of those who made history as pioneers in all these fields. Despite many constraints upon them, the pioneering women aspired to be thinkers, writers, educators, activists, and often reporters, and traveled to many different sites to become eyewitnesses and to write about issues that matter to them and to the larger society. Ms. Totenberg's body of work over the span of a half century since she started her career in the 1960s exemplifies that pioneering spirit, charting a new path and persevering with her work on the forefront of changing times. Ms. Totenberg's illustrious and remarkable career is the result of a combination of intellect, investigative mind, hard work, and tenacity. Best known and most loved as legal affairs correspondent for National Public Radio, she regularly files reports to All Things Considered, Morning Edition, and Weekend Edition. But she has also published articles in the New York Times Magazine, the Harvard Law Review, New York Magazine, and many others. Her in-depth knowledge of the legal system, along with her concise and effective writing, translates the complexities of the court into straightforward and relatable language. Her reporting also uncovers and examines issues that deserve public awareness and discussion, sometimes urgently so. For her distinguished reporting, Ms. Totenberg has so far earned every major journalism award in broadcasting. She is also the only radio journalist to have won the National Press Foundation Award for Broadcaster of the Year. The American Bar Association has honored her 7 times for continued excellence in legal reporting. I assume that, like me, many of you are long-time fans of Ms. Totenberg. Since she has been reporting to us about high-impact cases from the Supreme Court with clarity and depth, she also brings to the public attention the social and ethical dimensions of these court cases. For example, after Ms. Totenberg broke the news on Professor Anita Hill's allegation against the then nominee to the Supreme Court, Clarence Thomas, I remember being glued to NPR and following the hearings gavel to gavel. A renowned feminist law scholar at the time said that the series of hearings and the debate that ensued were, quote, a national teaching on sexual harassment. The issues and ramifications that were brought to our attention then had a profound impact on women and thus all of us, and they still do now all over the world. Ms. Totenberg is aware of the Supreme Court's role in shaping and impacting the lives of ordinary people, including those of women. She has been a witness to history as Justices Sandra Day O'Connor, Ruth Bader Ginsburg, Sonia Sotomayor, Elena Kagan, each with unique stories, became the stalwarts of the decision-making body of the highest court of the country. Ms. Totenberg's visit couldn't be more timely when women all over the country are concerned about what the future holds for us, as evidenced by recent national and local marches. The Supreme Court will do a great deal in determining our future, and therefore, Ms. Totenberg's speech today couldn't be more relevant to us all. Please join me welcoming Nina Totenberg.
Hi, everybody. Thank you for such a lovely introduction, Dean Langan. I feel that we definitely have the spirit of Lou Anne Dummer here tonight. I know there must be a lot of jokes about her last name and connected to the Women's Center, but I think calling it the Lou Anne Dummer Women's Center is the best idea yet. I really am greatly honored to be here today and to have been invited during Women's History Month. Let me start with something that's a true fact as opposed to an alternative fact. My job this evening is not just to inform you, but to amuse you, entertain you at least a little bit. So let me begin with a tale or two about the Supreme Court justices themselves. They're very smart folks, but they're still people with all the foibles and virtues that real people have. To prove my point, let me quote from some of the papers of the late Justice Harry Blackmun of Minnesota, who was, not to put too fine a point on it, a pack rat. And he saved everything from the formal memos that the justices exchange on legal cases to the little notes that they write to each other on the bench. And some of the bench notes he kept are hilarious. One in Blackmun's first year on the court from Chief Justice Berger, also a Minnesotan. That one observes from Berger, note blonde in second row center. She is here almost daily, at least since you came. Another in the 1990s, when Blackmun had been up late the night before, came from Justice Antonin Scalia. Harry, stay awake. Or this one from Justice Sandra Day O'Connor. Harry, I think your hearing aid is emitting quite a high-pitched sound. Can it be adjusted? And my personal favorite, on October 10th, 1973, with Vice President Spiro Agnew in legal trouble in the midst of a hot pennant race, the law clerk sent in a note that read, Vice President Agnew just resigned, Mets 2, Reds nothing. Now, although we don't have access to any of the justices' private papers, at least for the last 20 years or so, there is a fair amount of established lore about the individual justices. The court's newest member, Obama appointee Elena Kagan, went hunting quite frequently with the late Justice Scalia. The reason apparently is not only that she liked Scalia a great deal, but because when she was making the rounds on Capitol Hill prior to her confirmation hearings, a huge percentage of the senators asked this New York City native whether she had ever hunted. And after a while, she began promising them that she would try hunting once she was confirmed. And guess what? She liked it. Justice Sonia Sotomayor does a great many things that she doesn't get publicity for, although I suspect she is among the one or two most recognizable members of the court. She serves soup at soup kitchens every couple of weeks. She just goes in and works in a homeless shelter. One of my favorite stories about the justices comes from Justice Souter, who used to drive back to New Hampshire in his VW Beetle each year, and on one of these occasions, he stopped for lunch on the interstate, and a guy came over to him and he said, "Excuse me, but aren't you a Supreme Court justice?" Souter conceded that yes, he was. "See," the guy said, turning to his wife, "I told you he was Justice Breyer." Souter, of course, was too polite to correct him, but then the guy asked, "So tell me, Justice Breyer, what's your favorite thing about serving on the United States Supreme Court?" To which Souter replied, "Well, I think it's probably serving with Justice Souter." I have known many of the justices for a lot of years prior to their being named to the court. But the current justice, the sitting justice I have known the longest, is Ruth Bader Ginsburg, largely because I knew her when she was a quite young lawyer, in fact, the lawyer who was the architect in the 1970s of the legal battle for women's rights, and I was an even younger cub reporter covering the Supreme Court and knew exactly nothing. And I was reading a brief one day. It was the first major sex discrimination case to come before the court. And it made the argument that the 14th Amendment guarantee of equal protection of the law covered not just African Americans, but women too. And I thought, how can this be? I thought the 14th Amendment was a post-Civil War amendment. And so I flipped to the front of the brief, and it was written by a professor at Rutgers by the name of Ruth Bader Ginsburg. So I called her up and I got an hour-long lecture. And it was the beginning of a long friendship. One of my favorite Ginsburg stories dates back to that era and how she balanced or sometimes had difficulty balancing the demands of child rearing and the demands of litigation. Her son James was at some flossy school in New York City. And she kept getting calls because he kept getting in trouble. And these events would inevitably provoke calls demanding that Mrs. Ginsburg come to school to discuss her son's transgressions, one of which, as I recall, was that he kidnapped the elevator. Finally, on a day when a tired Ginsburg had been up all night writing a brief, she got one of these calls from the head of school or the headmistress or whatever. Only this time Ginsburg replied, "You know, this child has two parents and it's his father's turn." From now on, she said, "Please alternate these calls." As Ginsburg observes, after that the calls seemed to dry up. Calling father away from his work instead of mother proved quite an inhibitor. Ginsburg, of course, is the second woman to serve on the nation's highest court, the first being Justice Sandra Day O'Connor, appointed by President Reagan. Both women traversed quite a journey before reaching their exalted status. They began their careers at a time when women, simply because they were women, could legally be denied not just jobs, but mortgages, credit of all kinds, even the right to serve on a jury. These two women of that generation, however, had amazing, amazing self-confidence, always being sure somehow that they could be lawyers and leaders. How did they get that self-confidence? They learned self-reliance in very different ways. Think of young Sandra Day at age 15, driving a truck across her parents' enormous ranch in Arizona to deliver lunch to the ranch hands, miles away from anyone in the blazing Arizona sun. She gets a flat tire and changes it. She's 15. Changes it by jumping on the lug wrench until it finally loosened the lug nuts. But when she gets to the roundup, her father is furious at her, telling her, "You're late." Her excuse, "I had a flat tire and I had to change it," held no water whatsoever. "You should have started earlier," he grumped. Biographer Linda Hirschman theorizes from this, accurately, I think, that O'Connor took the lesson that she just had to suck it up and take whatever abuse the world handed out without complaining. It was, observes Hirschman, very good training for being the first woman on the United States Supreme Court. O'Connor, who graduated second in her class at Stanford Law School, was unable to find a job after graduation. Thank you. Was unable to find a job after graduation. The best offer she got, which she turned down, was an offer of a job as a, wait for it, typist at a big Los Angeles firm. She finally got her first lawyer job by offering to work for nothing for the district attorney of, I think it was Alameda County. She often observes that if she and Ginsburg had been offered jobs in law firms when they graduated from law school, they would now be retired firm partners instead of historic figures in the law. Ginsburg, raised in Brooklyn, had a wonderful but terminally ill mother who died when Ruth Bader was 17. Months later, the daughter would go to Cornell on scholarship and study in the bathroom. So she didn't look like the grunt she in fact was, because in those days, Cornell was a big party school. By the time she entered Harvard Law School, she and her husband Marty had a 2-year-old daughter. She found a way still to make high grades and law review, but the hurdles she faced would increase markedly when her husband was diagnosed with testicular cancer. Her typical day then turned into classes, followed by taking care of her daughter, playing with her daughter, feeding her daughter, followed by dinner for her husband at midnight when he could eat after lots and lots of radiation treatments, and having him dictate to her his senior thesis. By the time she'd completed all of those tasks, it was usually about 2 a.m, and she would turn to preparing for her next day's classes. I suspect this is how she learned to turn day into night, which she still does. After her husband recovered and graduated, the couple moved to New York, where she did her 3rd year at Columbia Law School, graduating tied for first in her class, and she was recommended for a Supreme Court clerkship. Times being what they were, however, she didn't even get an interview, nor a job offer at a firm. So she ultimately got a job in academia and hid her second pregnancy to ensure she got tenure. I give you these thumbnail sketches because they provide some insight about these two women in particular. One, the quintessential Westerner, the other, the quintessential New Yorker. One, O'Connor, spent years in elective office. The other spent years as a law professor, litigator, and distinguished federal judge. One, O'Connor, was nominated to the court by a conservative Republican. The other, by a liberal Democrat. One, a generally conservative justice. The other, a generally liberal one. And yet, as different as their backgrounds were and their approaches to judging, on issues involving women's rights in particular, they were allies on the Supreme Court, each in her own time, or both of them together, providing the decisive votes in closely divided cases. Now, I could have given you a thumbnail sketch of two other justices, Antonin Scalia and Clarence Thomas. Two conservatives from very different backgrounds. Thomas, an African-American from the Deep South. Scalia, an Italian-American from Queens, who spoke a little Yiddish and carried a rifle with him on the subway for ROTC at the parochial school that he attended. Or I could have told you about John Paul Stevens, a centrist Republican appointed to the court by President Ford, an intelligence officer who served in World War II, who decades later would write some of the court's Guantanamo decisions invalidating some of the Bush administration's actions in the wake of 9/11. Justice Stevens, who retired from the court in 2010 when he was 90, is still going strong nearly 7 years later, writing books, articles, playing tennis, and traveling. I chose not to talk at any length about these men, as distinguished and lovable as some of them are, for one simple reason. They're men, and I'm not. I have spent most of my professional life writing about men in public life, and I probably will be doing that for the rest of my professional life, for the most part anyway. So when I can these days, I write about women, especially during Women's History Month. Alas, though, this concludes what I would call the amusing part of my speech, the easy to digest part, the stuff that's only about people, not thoughts. So let's get to the news, the gossip, and President Trump's nomination of Judge Neil Gorsuch to the Supreme Court. Judge Gorsuch is 49. He's a highly regarded judge on the 10th Circuit Court of Appeals based in Denver. I've talked to lots and lots of people who know him, who've served with him, including many of his current colleagues. All describe him as an unfailingly polite, diplomatic person, a good listener, and a good colleague, to the point of being, as one put it, slightly kiss-assy. Reliably conservative on social issues, his best-known votes came in decisions about regulations under the Affordable Care Act. In the most celebrated of these, he voted to strike down the regulation requiring for-profit commercial employers to provide birth control coverage for women. His position was ultimately vindicated by a 5-4 Supreme Court majority, with the four dissenters, including the court's three women, protesting loudly that this was the first time that a religious exemption was being carved out for a law enacted to apply to all for-profit employers and most nonprofit employers as well. Judge Gorsuch is not only a Westerner, but a bit of a Washington-Colorado hybrid. A Colorado native, he was raised in Washington, D.C., where his mother, Ann Gorsuch Burford, was a highly controversial, take-no-prisoners, hard-drinking, hard-smoking head of the EPA during the Reagan administration. He earned his undergraduate degree at Columbia, where he co-founded a newspaper aimed at rebutting what he considered the dominant liberal and politically correct orthodoxy of the day on campus, and probably now as well. A graduate of Harvard Law School, he also earned a doctorate in legal philosophy at Oxford University, where he studied as a Marshall Scholar. In private practice in Washington, D.C., he represented mostly corporate clients, and in 2005, he became Principal Associate Attorney General in the Bush administration, Justice Department. A year later, he was nominated to the 10th Circuit Court of Appeals, where he has earned a reputation as a cerebral conservative with a flair for writing vividly that is similar to, though not as sharp in tone as Justice Scalia's flair for writing. Judge Gorsuch has not written much about some issues, like gun control, but he's written extensively about the modern administrative state, suggesting that perhaps the Supreme Court should reverse a decades-old decision that requires the courts to defer to agency interpretations of ambiguous provisions in broad federal statutes. Interestingly, that is one way in which Gorsuch is actually more conservative than Scalia. Scalia, who was an expert on administrative law, supported deference to such reasonable, and I stress here, reasonable agency interpretations. Scalia's theory was that it's better having political appointees and the bureaucrats who report to them in charge of interpreting regulatory statutes because they're accountable to the elected branches of government, as opposed to the courts, which are not accountable to the electorate. Gorsuch's view, and that to some degree also of Chief Justice John Roberts, is that ultimately the courts must be responsible for interpreting the law, and to leave it to the agencies is an abdication of the judicial duty. In the larger sense, it's fair, I think, to look at the Gorsuch nomination as both his supporters and critics do, as fulfilling the Trumpian pledge to his conservative base, to name someone in the mold of Justice Scalia. Scalia may not have been the originalist, as it were, but he popularized what once had been a fringe legal doctrine. He argued for it both on and off the Supreme Court and brought originalism into, if not the mainstream, then at least into the center of American legal debate. Judge Gorsuch is a self-proclaimed disciple of Scalia's crusade. Indeed, in a recent speech, he recalled how he wept on the ski slopes in Colorado upon learning of Scalia's death. Scalia famously described originalism this way, and I know this because this quote is from an interview he did with me. The Constitution that I interpret and apply is not living, but dead, or as I prefer to call it, enduring. It means today not what current society, much less the court, thinks it ought to mean, but what it meant when it was adopted, close quote. What drove the increasing acceptance of originalism on the Supreme Court was not only Scalia's commitment, but the growth of the conservative Federalist Society in academia, spawning in turn more and more advocates of the theory. Also significantly contributing was the luck of the Supreme Court draw. From 1980 on, Republican presidents got the chance to fill 7 Supreme Court seats, and at each rotation, the new justice was significantly more conservative than the person he or she replaced. That too reflected the increasingly conservative drift of the Republican Party, with evangelicals and other social conservatives gaining more power and influence. Scalia, Gorsuch, and other conservatives have embraced originalism as a way to check what they view or viewed as the growing and unbounded power of the judiciary. They have contended that if policy changes are to take place, the changes should come through the democratic process rather than through the unelected courts. In a 2016 lecture, Gorsuch praised Scalia for reminding us all that judges should strive, quote, to apply the law as it is, focusing backwards, not forward, and looking to text, structure, and history to decide what a reasonable reader at the time of the events in question would have understood the law to be. Of course, there are no records of the framers' conversations when they debated and drafted the Constitution, so no one knows precisely what they were thinking as they wrote it. Critics of originalism contend that its advocates pick and choose just Critics of originalism contend that its advocates pick and choose just when they're willing to defer to the elected branches. They note that originalists have been willing to strike down federal laws adopted by large bipartisan congressional majorities, that they've invalidated laws and reversed decades of precedents governing, for example, campaign finance regulations and voting rights, to name just 2 major areas. Gorsuch, as I said, has stressed, as have other originalists, that the job of a judge should be to look backward at what the founding fathers meant at the time they wrote and ratified the Constitution. Now, we do know something about the ratification debates. But one-time constitutional law professor Barack Obama summarized the critique of the originalist theory this way in his book, The Audacity of Hope. Anyone who seeks to resolve our modern constitutional disputes by looking at the Constitution's original meaning has one big problem, he said. The founders themselves disagreed profoundly, even vehemently, on the meaning of their masterpiece. Before the ink on the constitutional parchment was dry, arguments had erupted not just about minor provisions, but about first principles, not just between peripheral figures, but those within the revolution's very core. Some of the most discussed and controversial Supreme Court decisions come down to the justices' disagreements as to whether the Constitution should be viewed as dead or enduring, in Scalia's words, or living. Those disagreements were never more apparent than in a series of decisions about gay rights written by the usually, but not always, conservative Justice Anthony Kennedy, often dubbed the swing vote on the Supreme Court because he sometimes votes with the court's liberals. In his decision striking down a Texas law that criminalized private consensual homosexual conduct, Kennedy asserted that the Founding Fathers did not specify all liberties that were covered by the Constitution because they expected the list to change. Quote, "They knew times can blind us to certain truths, and later generations can see that laws once thought necessary and proper in fact serve only to oppress," Kennedy said. It is the promise of the Constitution, he went on to say, that there is a realm of personal liberty which the government may not enter. Scalia dissented, declaring, "It is clear from this that the court has taken sides in the culture war, and in particular in the battle of the culture war that concerns whether there should be any moral opprobrium attached to homosexual conduct." The same-sex marriage cases divided along similar lines. As Kennedy put it in speaking for the court majority, "The dynamic of our Constitution system is that individuals need not await legislative action before asserting a fundamental right, in this case, the right to marry." In a scathing dissent, Scalia said he would hide his head in a bag rather than sign on to an opinion like the one Kennedy wrote. Chief Justice Roberts was a bit more restrained, saying that questions like this should be left to the democratic process. Allowing unelected judges to strike down democratically enacted laws based on rights that are not actually written in the Constitution raises obvious concerns about the judicial role, he said. Until really quite recently, ideology had only occasionally played a major role in Supreme Court appointments. President Roosevelt famously tried to overcome the Supreme Court's conservative opposition to the New Deal by proposing the expansion of the number of justices. The proposal died after Justice Owen Roberts, no relation to the current Chief Justice, appeared to switch his vote on a key piece of New Deal legislation, resulting in a 5-4 decision to uphold it. The switch became known as the switch in time saves 9. Current scholarship suggests Roberts actually may have switched his vote before the court packing plan was proposed, however. Although the court packing plan would eventually go down in infamy and cost Roosevelt dearly in the next election, he would nonetheless get what he wanted over time, as he replaced all of the conservative members of the court who had struck down one piece of New Deal legislation after another. The subsequent Roosevelt appointees disagreed about many, many things, but they agreed in their deference to Congress in enacting economic regulation. For most of the 20th century, ideology played second fiddle to politics in Supreme Court appointments. Some scholarship suggests, for example, that Dwight Eisenhower promised to name Republican Governor Earl Warren to the first Supreme Court vacancy in order to secure California's delegates at the 1952 GOP nominating convention. And in 1956, shortly before Eisenhower's second election, he named William J. Brennan to the court because the president's political advisors thought that the nomination of a Catholic, Democratic, state court judge from the Northeast would help the Republican president attract votes in his reelection bid. He would win overwhelmingly, but Warren and Brennan would turn out to be huge liberal forces on matters of race and criminal law. President Nixon exploited the unpopularity of some of those decisions in his campaign for the presidency in 1968. But three of the four men he appointed to the court had center-right records and turned out to be center-right justices. And even President Reagan, who avowedly wanted to move the court to the right, big time, only succeeded in putting two hardcore conservatives on the court, one of them, the late Justice Scalia. All of this occurred, however, at a time when senators in both parties were willing to cast votes against their own president's nominee in quite significant numbers, and conversely, to support the other party's nominee in significant numbers. That started to erode when President Reagan appeared to have a more ideological bent in his appointments, and the democratically controlled Senate finally rebelled on the Bork nomination after Democrats joined Republicans in unanimously confirming Scalia. Despite the acrimony of the Bork fight, as late as the 1990s, President Clinton's Supreme Court nominees, Justices Ginsburg and Breyer, were approved with only token opposition and overwhelming majority support in both parties. That has not been true since then. Democrats split evenly over the nomination of John Roberts to be Chief Justice, 22 for, 22 against. And the last three nominees, one Republican and two Democrats, have had opposition party support only in the single digits. Indeed, it may be that none would have been confirmed if the president's party didn't also control the Senate. Which brings us to now. Democrats were infuriated when Senate Republican leader Mitch McConnell took the unprecedented step, and it was unprecedented, of blocking any action whatsoever for nearly a year on President Obama's appointment of a highly admired centrist liberal judge, Merrick Garland. Many Democrats say openly that the nomination was stolen from them, and the first chaotic month of the Trump presidency has energized and even radicalized the Democratic base to the point that they're now doing to Democrats what the conservative base has been doing to Republicans for considerably longer, pushing them farther and farther out to the edges and threatening members of the Senate with primary opposition if they don't oppose Gorsuch. So for what it's worth, and that, by the way, is exactly what Mitch McConnell did to anybody that wanted to get off the reservation on the garment fight. And the same thing is going to happen on the other side. So for what it's worth, my prediction is that most Democrats will vote against Gorsuch, but there won't be enough votes to sustain a filibuster. And if there are, the Republicans will do what the frustrated Democrats did in 2013 for lower court judges, and what President Trump has already suggested be done for Supreme Court nominations as well. They will abandon the filibuster altogether for nominations. Whatever happens, the current vacancy may not be the only one. Retirement, health problems, or death might well claim any of the court's older justices. Justice Ginsburg, appointed by President Bill Clinton, is about to turn 84. Justice Kennedy, a Reagan appointee, is 80. And Justice Breyer, also appointed by President Clinton, is 78. After this year, I'm loath to make political predictions. But if you're a Democrat, for example, looking to the next election in 2018, remember that the Republicans who now narrowly control the Senate will be defending only 8 Senate seats compared to the 23 seats that the Democrats would be defending along with 2 independents who now caucus with the Democrats. The Gorsuch nomination is an effort to preserve the status quo, for Republicans anyway, a 5-4 conservative majority in most cases, but not all. And as I indicated, there could well be as many as 3 more slots to fill in the Trump years. Even 1 more slot would move the court dramatically to the right. And 3 openings would move the court to a pretty much 7-2 conservative majority, with little likelihood of an Anthony Kennedy-type conservative who votes on some important matters with the liberal justices. The move would be dramatic because the conservative members of the current court are already so much more conservative, by and large, than the people they replaced. Indeed, Justice Stevens, a Republican appointee, considered a moderate conservative when he was named to the court in the mid-70s, came to be considered the most liberal member of the court by the time that he retired just a few years ago. That's not because he's changed or did change. It's because the composition of the court changed and moved so decidedly to the right. What would be the concrete results? Probably increased hostility to claims of voter suppression, increased hostility to discrimination claims, civil rights claims, or environmental claims, increased hostility to unions. I expect that'll happen very quickly, even with the Gorsuch nomination. And at some point, a real possibility that major precedents like Roe versus Wade might be reversed. What will be particularly interesting will be how a conservative court treats this new president when he, instead of Obama, flexes his executive muscles. The conservatives on the court, most of whom served in executive branch positions when they were younger, were advocates of executive power. But they became quite hostile to such powers, first actually during part of the Bush administration, and during the Obama presidency even more. Conversely, the court's liberals were somewhat less hostile to Obama's use of executive power. It will be truly fascinating to see how the court reacts to President Trump and his assertion of power of the presidency. So I usually like to end on a not quite so serious note, but we live in fairly serious times with quite comedic overtones. I do not have the talent of Mr. Colbert or John Stewart or any of a number of other people. So I thought, for those of you who know the story, I will tell it again. And for those of you who don't, I will tell it for the first time. It has nothing to do with the Supreme Court. And because I have an update, as they say. So about a year and a half ago, on the last day of the court term, my husband has learned over the course of years not to call me on deadline, least of all on the last day of the court term. So at about 6:30, my phone rang, and I picked up the line, and he said, "You know, you got a call from the FBI today." And I said, "Oh, they're always checking up on people for security clearances, you know, former interns of mine and people like that." He said, "Well, it was the art section." That did give me a moment's pause. He had been unable to reach them by the time he got home and called them back. My father, who was a great concert violinist, had had his Stradivarius violin stolen from him. It's now 37 years ago. And it was never recovered, even though he had always thought he knew who had taken it. But he could never get the FBI to get a search warrant. So on the next morning, I called the Bureau, and I called the number that had been left for me. And Agent Chris McKeough answered his line, and I identified myself, and I said, "You called." And he said, "Well, Ms. Totenberg, we think we've recovered your father's violin." And I really didn't believe it. I mean, it had been gone a very long time. My father died at 101, and at that point, it had only been 4 years since he died. And I said, "Are you sure?" And he said, "We really are pretty sure." And then I said, "You know, you must have some files about the violin." But it turned out, really, they didn't. First of all, when it was stolen, it was worth a lot less. And for whatever reason, maybe because of that, with these big items, even when they were less valuable than now, if you don't get them back very quickly in a week or two, you're not going to get them back in all likelihood. So he said, "Can you tell me anything that might help us identify the violin?" And I said, well, what makes you think that it's my dad's violin? He said, well, we've had it appraised by two separate people, and they believe it's his. And I said, well, his violin had pearl inserts on the tuning pegs. And he said, well, it's sitting right here in front of me, and it has pearl insets in the tuning pegs. And I said, can you tell me how you recovered it? And initially, he didn't. He said, you know, we have to really cross all the I's and dot all the T's and make sure there's nobody involved that we don't think is involved, da, 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 da. And I then began thinking, okay, they recovered it from the mob or something like that, and somebody in exchange. Well, of course, it turned out to be none of the above, and I helped them close the case by finding my father's former secretary who'd been there the night it was stolen after a concert. And turned out that the person who had stolen it was, in fact, the guy my father thought had stolen it. And he was a young musician in his early 20s, who I guess thought that if he had a Stradivarius violin that he would have a great career, which he ended up not having. And he was a considerable disappointment, let's put it that way, to a lot of people, not the least of whom was his wife. But she took him in when he was dying of pancreatic cancer at the age of 55 or something like that. And he left two violins with her. Now, remember, my father was, I think, still alive when this man died. My father was 101 when he died, teaching on his deathbed. And so after a few years, she had a new boyfriend, and they were cleaning up the house, and they found these two fiddles, and one of them had a combination lock on it. And they finally broke the lock, and they opened it, and it said, there was a violin in there, and it said Stradivarius. Well, she knew enough to know that there are probably millions of violins that say Stradivarius in them that are not Stradivarius violins. So she got the name of an appraiser, and she called him up, and he said, send me some photographs. And he looked at the photographs, and they looked pretty good. And ultimately, they met in New York at a hotel. She lived in California. And he looked at the violin for about half an hour, and he said to her, well, I have some good news for you and some bad news for you. The good news is it's a genuine 1734 Stradivarius. The bad news is it was stolen from Roman Totenberg 35 years ago, and I have to call the FBI now. And he called the FBI right away, and within 20 minutes, Chris McKeough was at that hotel with his partner, and they were, and on the way over, they called up on Google all the stats on the violin, all the centimeters from here to there, and they stood there saying, you know, 15 centimeters this, and the appraiser said, and they'd go, yep, yep, yep. And that was a Friday afternoon, and I think they must have finished quite late, and he called me Monday, which was the last day of court, and he said, he ultimately said to me, I came to work so excited this morning because I'd never seen anything so beautiful. Well, to make a longer story short, we managed to get it back quite quickly, thanks to some very good legal help. And they had a big press conference in the Southern District of New York press office in New York. It was the largest press conference they'd ever had, which is saying something for the Southern District, where they indict financiers and mobsters. But there were like 15 TV crews and 25 still photographers and another 30 or 40 reporters. And it was on the front page of the New York Times and the front of the style section in the Washington Post. And I, because who did most of the talking at the press conference, was on television all over the world speaking the most enormous array of languages imaginable. I spoke Japanese, I spoke Portuguese, I spoke French, I spoke German. My lips moved and the most amazing languages came out of my face. In any event, the Bureau, at that press conference, I've also never seen that many high-ranking law enforcement people from so many agencies in my life. And the Bureau, fortunately, took the guy who was going to work on the violin from Rare Violins of New York, that he took him back, because normally they walk around Manhattan, those guys, with Strads and Guarneri violins, and they take the subway, but we figured with all the publicity that might not be such a good idea, so we got Chris to take him back to his office and his vault, and it's been in restoration for the last year and a half, and it is finally finished. And next week, my father's former student, Miro Wang, who came to study with him from China, and has gone on to have a fine career of her own, is going to debut the violin at a concert in New York City, private concert at a private club in New York City. And the three Totenberg sisters will all be there. So will, I suppose, a few reporters who are not allowed to mention the name of the club, because the club is a very flossy club, and you wouldn't want their name in the newspaper. And I have no idea what it sounds like. All I can tell you is when we got it back, it was beautiful then. I'm sure it's even more beautiful now. Thank you very much. So, I'm supposed to take questions for somewhere between 15 and 30 minutes. We'll see who gives out first, me or you. And I don't see any microphones. Yes? No? No microphones? Yes? If you think I can see. Yeah, I can hear you. I'll repeat what you say. If you have a question, please raise your hand tall and somebody will come find you with a microphone. I certainly won't be able to see you because this could be a really... Yeah, back there? Well, certainly when I first knew her, I had no idea that she was going to be a Supreme Court justice one day. The question was that I'd referred to Justice Ginsburg as a friend, and I once said the same thing when Justice Scalia died about him, and I got unshirted hell from one listener who said, you know, we don't expect you to have friends on the Supreme Court. Well, I'm sorry, but, you know, they're the same people. They're there for 30 years. I'm not going to pretend that I don't know them. Part of my job is to know them. But when I first knew both Scalia and Ginsburg, I really had no idea either one would ever end up on the Supreme Court. There were no women on the Supreme Court at the time when I first met her. And when I first met him, I think that it was during the Nixon administration. And he was in the Justice Department during the Nixon administration. So it's not my policy to drop people just because they get famous. I was incredibly fond of the late Justice Scalia. He was a wonderful human being and a great friend. And we still have his wife over for dinner. And my husband, who's a surgeon, took pretty good care as a not official doctor of Justice Ginsburg's husband when he was dying, and of her when she was sick. I mean, God knows he didn't operate on her, but he, you know, if she wants to know, is so-and-so, you know, do you think this is good advice? Do you think I should go see, is this a good doctor? Would you check him out for me? He does. And he does that for anybody who asks, is the truth, as well. I tease him by calling him the doctor to the stars. But to have been fortunate enough to know somebody like either Ginsburg or Scalia is to have been very fortunate to know truly remarkable human beings. 2 years ago, I interviewed the two of them together before an audience of about 1,500 people at Lisner Auditorium and at George Washington University. And they were both in fine fettle. They came to play. They teased each other. They argued with each other. They told great stories about each other. And because I'd known them both for like 40 years, I knew what some of those stories were, and I could pull it out of them. It's a great advantage to know somebody for a long time when you cover them. It has its disadvantages, too. there are times when it's difficult. When Justice Ginsburg spoke about Trump during the campaign, and I had a long scheduled interview with her that I was doing. It was basically a biographical interview for, not for NPR, for another organization, with the understanding that I could use any of the material for NPR if I needed to. But it was all stuff I knew. It was about her life. But I am a reporter, so I always try to get some news out of her. So I told her I was going to ask her about what she'd said about Trump. And she said, oh, please don't ask me that. I said, look, you cannot answer me. You can yell at me if you want, but that's my job. She never tells me anything about what she's writing or what other people are doing at the court. That's her job. She's not supposed to tell me that stuff, and she doesn't. My job is to ask her uncomfortable questions if they're there, and I do it. Is it pleasant? Not particularly, but it's my job. And guess what? I think she understands that. Even Scalia, who is oddly even more sensitive than she is, understood that. When he finally issued a memorandum, as I think what he called it, about his duck hunting with Vice President Cheney, it was a huge hunt. I mean, he wasn't in the same duck blind, there have been all kinds of misinformation about how he got there and who paid for it and all kinds of stuff. So finally, after getting no answers out of him or the court for weeks, he finally issued a memorandum explaining what had happened. The first half of the memo was terrific. It had really good information with, you know, stuff you could check, and it was extremely helpful. The second half was a tirade about the press, and I said to him afterwards, I said, Nino, the first half was fabulous. I said, just remember, when you write a tirade about the press, we own the ink. I said, the reason there were all those mistakes is you wouldn't answer any questions. And he went like this, made me feel better. So it's problematic, but not as problematic as you might think. Probably pretty much because it isn't a political beat. It may be an ideological beat from time to time, from a lot of times, but it's not a political beat. So it's not like you're schmoozing with a senator or a congressman or a White House aide, and they let drop something, and you're not sure if they knew what they were doing. My policy always is to say to them, either right then or the next day, it's usually better the next day, say, you know, you said yesterday X. You didn't say it was off the record, and so it's on the record. As far as I'm concerned, and I've had negotiating sessions with people. I've held stories until they could get their ducks in a row, so that they didn't get horribly embarrassed, so that I wouldn't burn them, but I wasn't going to miss out on the story. It's a tough balance, but you have to make it. You don't find out things by saying so far above the fray that you know nobody and they don't trust you. Yeah.
Tell your 20-year-old, what would you tell your 20-year-old self in the balcony?
What would I tell my 20-year-old self? I guess I would tell my 20-year-old self what I really did understand by the time I was 30 or 35, that you can't fight every battle, that you have to pick your battles and make sure they're the ones you really want to fight, because you can't, there's not enough ammunition to go around for every battle, every insult, everything. And I said to a group of young women today, I said, it's very hard for you to understand what life was like for me when I started out. And it's very hard for me to understand how relatively easy it is for you that you sometimes, people of your generation come to me with complaints about the most minor of things, in my view. But I can't put myself in your shoes, because I'm not in your shoes. I don't have your experiences. I had my experiences. And it was very much a suck it up and move on time. I'm more of the O'Connor-Ginsburg view because I'm closer to their generation. They're both older than I am by a fair amount, but not that much. And I was lucky enough to get a job, and I was very lucky. And every place I worked for the first 15 years of my life, my professional life, I was either the only woman or one of two. And that's just not the way it is anymore. It's totally different. And for that, we have Justices Ginsburg and O'Connor to thank a good deal. Yeah, there was somebody over here. I can't see where you are, so.
Sorry.
Okay.
One theory of the preservation of our Constitution and the future of our country is that the press and the courts as our institutions will save us. And you're in a unique position as a member of the press and a reporter on the courts to address that. So in what ways can you save
us? So let me just say something important here. I can't. You have to save yourselves. And part of that is being, this sounds so like Civics 101, an educated citizen. And that means reading stuff you don't agree with. That means reading the Wall Street Journal editorial page if you really don't agree with it. Read it anyway. It's well written. It's well reasoned. You might not agree with it. Or find somebody else whose views are interesting. If you're only in an echo chamber, it's really bad for a democracy, and it's really boring. Unbelievably boring. And you'll never change anything you think. Ultimately, in the end, though, I think most reporters, good reporters, think that their job is not to save you. Their job is to inform you. And we're not always perfect. Some of us are less perfect than others. But I've made mistakes in my life, and you should check. If something sounds like it's not reasonable, doesn't make sense to you, check it. We live in the computer age. You can at least Google it and see a lot of data on it. I mean, NPR started, and now other people do this, I've noticed, is we started annotating Trump press conferences, Trump speeches. It's not perfect, but it's an instant fact checking. And if you divide it up among all of you, it's amazing how much as a group, a large group of reporters knows. So if he wants to say that the Ninth Circuit Court of Appeals is the most reversed court in the country by the Supreme Court, I know as a fact, and I know where I can lay my fingers on the information very fast, like in less than 5 minutes. I know that's not true. Now, nobody else knows that's not true. That's the most minor amount of batshit imaginable. But I know it. It's my beat, and I know it. And Carrie Johnson knows what the murder rate is now and what it was in 2000 and what it was in 1991. And she can spew those statistics out and lay her hands on them in less than 5 minutes, too. And the economic people know the stats on unemployment and who's genuinely unemployed and who's not genuinely unemployed. Now, we didn't do this with other presidents. In some significant measure because they shaded the truth, but they didn't lie. In amazing a number of cases, presidents like to try to deliver on their promises and would prefer not to lie if at all possible. They may get handed occasionally some information that they misuse, but for the most part, they know that we're jackals out there. We're gonna get them. And The only difference this time around is that it doesn't seem to matter most of the time, but it will. It will. We're only 40 days in. Either. I mean, I could be wrong, but I have great faith in this country. I am the daughter of an immigrant. I have great faith in this country and its ability to get through bad times and come out, if not better, okay. Prognostication is not my specialty, however, as I've told you. I don't know a reporter in Washington who this year wants to be a prognosticator after being, forget whether you said it on TV or the radio or not. I mean, what did you tell your husband and your sisters and your parents or whatever? You were wrong, 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 wrong from A to Z, from the beginning of the year to the end. So I'm hardly here to make you a promise about a rose garden, but I can tell you that you can't judge any administration 40 days in, for good or ill. Sometimes they get a hell of a lot better. I mean, in both Obama and Clinton's cases, they learned to be president by the time they had a second term and didn't have Congress anymore. That's a hell of a way to learn. But that's 4 years of on-the-job learning. And they were much more experienced governors than the current occupant of the office. So let's wait and see. I think that nobody stays impervious to falsity forever, but it does take time.
Also in the middle here. Hi.
Here. Okay.
I'm short. You have watched Ruth Bader Ginsburg kind of grow up because you saw her when she was sort of a cub lawyer and a cub professor, et cetera.
I was cubbier, so to me she seemed like a giant. Yes, sorry, I didn't mean to.
As you've seen Sotomayor and Kagan be on the courts in these past, you know, 4, 8, 5 years, what are your conceptualizations of them in the past years that you've seen them, and also how do you see them continuing to go forward?
I'm not ultimately sure. I mean, Kagan is significantly younger than Sotomayor. Sotomayor must be over 60 now. And my guess, and that's all it is that if she had her druthers, she would retire and go back to New York at some point when there's a Democratic president, and that might have been during a Clinton presidency, but it's not in the cards now. So I don't, you know, and you can never know what's going to happen to people health-wise. Justice O'Connor had breast cancer and survived that, but it was a tough year for her. Justice Ginsburg has had 2 bouts with serious cancer, 1 with colon cancer, 1 with pancreatic cancer. So you just never know what's going to befall people. I, you know, when I said I was a much cubbier reporter, I mean, Ruth Ginsburg, when she was arguing those cases in the Supreme Court, was in her 30s and early 40s. She was, by my lights today, a kid. But believe me, if you listen to those arguments, and you can go online and hear them, it doesn't sound like any kid. And she had a thoroughly strategic idea of how that completely worked out, of how she was going to tackle each issue and how she was going to, how each case would be litigated and how it would be argued. And that doesn't mean, I once asked her if she was nervous, especially the first time she argued. And she said, well, yes, the first time she argued, I think she had 10 or 15 minutes of the argument. She had half of the argument on her side. And she said she was so nervous that she didn't eat lunch because she was afraid she was going to throw up. And then she, when she got in front of the court, she suddenly realized she had a captive audience for 15 minutes. And she was very strategic about whose vote she was going after and how and with what tools. And somebody once asked her, I overheard this in the hallway, somebody, she was leaving an argument, and somebody said to her, why didn't you answer Justice Stevens' question? He asked you the same question three times. She said, because if I'd answered his question, I would have lost Justice Powell's vote. I mean, this, she had thought this through all the way. There's this very good book called Sisters-in-Law about the two of them that I quoted in my talk. And I think the author is correct that O'Connor was the perfect first, but because she essentially was, she'd only been a judge for a few years, and she was a state court judge, and she'd essentially been a politician, which served her very well on the court. Justice Breyer once said of her that she had the best political instincts for how far you could go on some issues and how and things that you shouldn't do. He said much better than his instincts. And but because of that, she did everything step by step. And she sliced the salami very thin sometimes, meaning that it left a lot of room to be reinterpreted later on. Ginsburg never did that. She sometimes went slowly, but she took every step with great measure, knowing what the next step was going to be, and the step after that, and the step after that. And they're very different approaches to the law, but they work together perfectly. And I know that for the, I think it was 3 years that Ginsburg was the only woman on the court. She really missed having other women on the court. She really missed O'Connor. And I think O'Connor really was terribly sad that she had retired when she did. It was a miscalculation. She didn't realize how sick her husband was going to get and how precipitously. And she thought that she didn't realize that Rehnquist was going to die very quickly. And in fact, so she quit, saying we can't have two vacancies at once. She was waiting for him to retire. He didn't retire. And then he died in August. She retired in June, the end of June, and he died in August. So, and I know, I think, quite clearly that she regrets leaving, not just for herself, which is usually the reason that people regret leaving, but because her legacy is being dismembered to a significant extent, a much more sort of modest approach to decision making than succeeded her, and definitely less attuned to what she would view as the needs of women.
Question to your left here.
My left.
Will we ever be able to hear Justice Thomas speak, and how is his demeanor looked at or perceived by the other justices?
I'm not sure how it's perceived by the other justices. I don't think it's perceived the way you perceive it. I mean, he did speak this year after Scalia died, or last year after Scalia died. He asked a question, and he hasn't asked one since that I know of. That I think he would have thought that Scalia would have asked, and it was quite soon after he died, and it was a gun case. And so I think it was about whether, if it's a fundamental right, it's a fundamental right. You can't just shave it here and shave it there. And I think he did that sort of almost as a tribute to Scalia. I think that his colleagues think it's idiosyncratic, but I don't think beyond that they think that much about it. He was a very active questioner when he was on the Court of Appeals. And I'm not, you know, he's given a variety of explanations for why, but I actually take him at his word that he thinks the court is so active now that it's rude to counsel, that they often can't get a word in edgewise between the questions. It's not at all uncommon for there to be, 50 to 75 questions in the course of a half-hour argument. And so I think he thinks it's rude and that they ought to let them talk. And and Scalia definitely thought the opposite. He said, he said that he hated, the one thing he hated when he was arguing a case, when he was an appellate advocate, was not to get interrupted because he didn't know what was bothering the members of the court. But this is not something they agreed about, clearly. you're welcome.
Hey, Nina, I'm over here too.
Over on this side.
Yeah. I hear, we hear this phrase, activist judges, a lot, and it always strikes me that when somebody says that, they mean that's a judge whose opinions or decisions I don't really like. But
that's about right.
If I agree with them, they're a good judge. If I don't,
activism is in the eye of the beholder, I think.
Okay.
I mean, nobody is consistent. Not all the time. And there's almost, I've had this discussion with many members of the court when I've interviewed them. And the reason they can't give me a good answer is that there isn't one. So how do you, if you're a liberal justice and you say you should defer to the legislature, how do you explain then that you strike down an anti-abortion law? Or if you're a conservative justice who says you defer to the legislature, how do you explain that you strike down the voting rights law, which not only has been on the books for decades, but was reenacted by huge bipartisan majorities? There isn't a good answer, except that this is an issue you think the Congress has gone too far on, that it's exceeded the constitutional bounds. And there is no consistent answer, because different judges and justices have different bugaboos. They care about, some of them are First Amendment purists. I would argue that we have a great many of those now, and some of the ways in which the First Amendment is used to strike down legislation is a backdoor way at invalidating laws that are economic in nature, in some nature or other. And others, you know, for some, women's rights are all important. And therefore, regulations, you know, laws that regulate abortion clinics very severely are not acceptable. I mean, there just isn't but nobody has a perfect record where they say, I have never voted to strike down a law that X, you know, that doesn't defer to the legislature on economic legislation. That's just not true. It's just not true. But it's just sufficiently more complicated than it sounds when you hear either side's characterization of what kind of a non-activist judge they are. Yeah.
You have asked us to become educated, and I think a lot of us have become much more active as well as educated. How are judges, and we've become educated and active in working with Congress and elected officials, how do judges learn, and do they change as we get older, we supposedly mellow and we become more open-minded? How do we influence judges, or how do you see them changing as they're getting older on the bench?
Sometimes they change, sometimes they don't. Some people become more rigid, if anything, as they get older. Some people get wiser with age. And more flexible. Some people get more incensed by events or their colleagues or fill in the blank. Other people can sort of go right above it all. I would have to say that on the current court, I don't think, you know, they get along. They were not perhaps the best buddies that some of them used to be. Like Ginsburg and Scalia were great friends, and I know how much she must miss him, even though they were each other's foils half the time. But I think that ultimately we all are the product of our own experiences to some extent, and you can't nor should you take that out of the judge. You wouldn't want a female judge who's had no female experiences. That's crazy. You want them to have experiences as a woman. They to bring that to the table, just the way you want an African American or a Hispanic or a poor or a rich judge to bring that to the table. What you don't want are people all the same, and in some sense, we are much more that way now than we used to be, because people, it's now sort of a given that you want a judge who's predictable on a lot of issues, not just one area like economic regulation. You have a whole list, and I would argue that Republicans have a longer list, because they've always cared, at least in modern life, they've cared more about the court. They've been angrier about the court. They've been angry about criminal law decisions. They were angry about abortion, angry about same-sex marriage, some of them. It's reflective of their base. Right now, lefties are angrier than righties are. And it's because they feel they have more to be angry about. Now you know what it feels like. That's the way the right has felt for a very long time. It's why Fox exists the way it exists. I can't, you know, Justice O'Connor had a lot of experience as a politician. She was the Republican leader of the Arizona Senate at a time when there were very few women in political life. And she knew how to work the system. Justice Breyer spent a lot of time, actually, in politics. He was the chief counsel for the Senate Judiciary Committee, working for Teddy Kennedy for several years. He saw the master politician at work, and he thought that's the way it ought to be, because there was a great deal of consultation back and forth in those days. But it isn't that way anymore, and I don't think he fully understands that, because it's not the world that he knew. And you can't just jettison people into an institution in time. They only know the institution at the time they're there. So the people who served in the executive branch in the Reagan and Bush 1 administrations, who are now on the court, Alito, Roberts, and Thomas, all of them had experiences in a different time. And I have no idea how the Trump behavior is perceived by them. Absolutely no idea whatsoever. I'm pretty sure how they voted, but but that doesn't tell me, that tells me, I have lots of Republican friends who voted for Trump. They held their nose and they voted for Trump. Many of them because they're businessmen, and many of them because they cared about the court. And about what they, how they perceive the last 40 days, I have no idea. Absolutely no idea. Nino would have told me about how he thought about it. I would have been able to figure that out. I'm really miss having him around. That wouldn't have been improper for him to say, because he could have said, what's he doing? Or he could have said, it's about time somebody said that. My suspicion is he might have said, it's about time somebody said that.
I have a question here on the back. Your back right.
Mm-hmm.
Left, sorry. Back back left high.
The other right. The other right over there.
Yes, the other one. Sorry. My question is, as a young mother myself, wanting to be an adversary for young women, including my own 7-year-old child, what do you see, or how do you see the courts moving with women's issues, specifically like around abortion or birth control or things like that into the future? And how, as a young mom, can I help educate, you know, my child and continue to believe and teach what I believe in are women's rights, when like we have Justice Ginsburg, who is older, and may not live forever, though I'm hoping she will. You know, how can we move forward from this, or continue to be advocates for our children?
Well, you know what you believe in. As the saying goes, you've got access; they don't. You know, you children do tend ultimately, maybe not when they're teenagers, but ultimately to reflect, if not the party, the values of their parents. Which is why those Thanksgiving dinner conversations can be so bitter, because you do share values, but you don't share conclusions. So I can't really give you advice about that. I mean, you know what you believe, and you're the mother. I don't actually know. I would say, as of this moment, there is a modest liberal, for want of a better expression, tilt or on women's rights due to Justice Kennedy's vote sometimes. But if he goes, and he could very well decide to retire this year, there's at least one school of thought who said that the Trumpies picked Gorsuch as a way of saying to Kennedy, you see, it'll be fine. You can go now. You can step down now. I really don't know. I think the only thing you can be sure of is that conservatives are very clear about what they want on the court, and they will get it. So it does matter who's president. Democrats and liberals care about what they want on the court, but they don't care with the same fervor. They haven't been deprived as long as conservatives have been deprived. And even though the court has gotten more and more and more conservative, not on a couple of the issues that conservatives care most about, abortion and same-sex marriage or gay rights, it's not the same. The gay rights questions are not the same today as they were 10 or 15 years ago, but they cared about them then, and they still care about them now. And religious rights and the right to not participate. I mean, there is this law, the Religious Freedom Restoration Act, which was passed by huge majorities of both houses of Congress, led by the Democrats, that overturned a Scalia opinion that said, and the Scalia opinion said, as long as a law, our test for whether a law is unconstitutional on religious grounds, religious discrimination grounds, rests really only on one thing. If it applies to everybody the same way, if it doesn't choose who it applies to, if it's an across-the-board law, it's constitutional. That may mean that it'll hurt some people more than others, or there will be those who say, this is against my religion, but if, in this case, this was a case about smoking peyote, which Native American groups said was a part of their religious free exercise. He said, these laws that you lost your, I think they lost unemployment compensation because they were on peyote or something like that. These laws apply to everybody equally. If you use peyote, you can't get certain benefits, or you can be arrested, or you can whatever, fill in the blank. It was a clear, bright line rule that was much more definitive than the court had been prior to that, where it said, we'll balance religious rights and the application of things to everybody. And so when the court made that decision, and I think it was 5-4, and Scalia wrote it, the Congress overturned it, and it gave, in the statute, it gave the upper hand to religion. And it hasn't been struck down yet. So, you know, it could be repealed at any time, but I see no likelihood of that. Okay. Okay, folks. One more question, and then we're going to quit.
Okay, I get the last question.
Yes.
I was wondering if you could tell us.
Where are you?
I'm in the middle here.
There you are.
Hello. I was wondering if you could tell us about the most memorable day you've experienced at the court or most memorable decision that has come down from the court.
I can't actually tell you what the most is because the most is usually the most recent memorable one. I think that the most memorable day, and I'm not sure that this wasn't, that it wasn't that I was quite young at the time, was the Pentagon Papers case. And there were many decisions, many big justices spoke for some time, and it was very parochially interesting to me because it was a press case. And I really, it was the first time in modern history that even for a nanosecond, anybody had been able to shut down publication of an otherwise truthful story. So I had, talk about worrying about democracy, I worried about democracy over that. And it was a 6-3 decision, and that I think was an extremely memorable day. That the day that the court upheld the ACA was extremely memorable because every aspect of it was unexpected. It was unexpected that the Chief Justice would be the fifth vote. It was unexpected that there, if he were the fifth vote, that there wouldn't also be a sixth vote. It was unexpected that the court would uphold the law as a tax, a legitimate constitutional tax, when not one single other judge in the country had ever seen it that way. It was extraordinary in the sense that for the first time the court said that the carrot and sticks of a federal program, in this case Medicaid, had gone too far. It was just every twist and turn of it was unexpected. And then, of course, there were the same-sex marriage cases, which came at the end of the term, so we knew when they were coming, pretty much. And it was just a quite moving and sensational moment in court where people were weeping, and it was extraordinary. Or there was the day when the court struck down a key provision of the Voting Rights Act, to the great consternation of particularly African Americans in the South. So I it's like saying, which of your children do you love most? They're great stories. I mean, that it's when you come to the end of the term, and mostly these cases come out at the end of the term, what you pray for is that it's clear what they've done, that it's not a mishmash that you'll never be able to explain. The Gitmo cases were really hard to explain. They were very hard to explain, but at least the outcome was, the bottom line was clear. And that also was those were great stories. So I don't have a favorite or a, you know, when the day comes that they reverse Roe versus Wade, that'll be a great story too. You may not like that outcome, some of you in this room. Others of you will be thrilled. Doesn't matter to me. It may matter to me personally. Doesn't really matter. It's a great story. It's a great yarn. It will have been if that ever happens, it will have been a hell of a 50-year trail. If I really wanted to be, as I said earlier today to a group that I talked to, if I really wanted to be an advocate, I'd be an advocate. I never wanted to be an advocate. I wanted to be a witness and to tell people great stories and to do it in a with a narrative and a vividness that they would remember it and understand it and want to know more. So thank you so much.